I played anywhere I could in Austin. The chance of a paying gig was pretty slim, but I had to get my name around, so I'd take anything, or invent something. No matter what the obstacle, I could take it, and more often than not, turn it around. The worst gigs I ever had were back in Albany anyway, a trailer park where, when they passed the hat, I got a gum wrapper, a camp reunion where I played under a low tarp in the rain, and the water kept dumping on me until my guitar was so wet the wood buckled. But it was a volleyball game that took the prize. 500 kids at a Catholic college. I played while they smacked that volleyball around. Nobody paid attention to me. They yelled over the music, and I'm pretty damn loud. And oddly enough, the priest, when he paid me $500, my biggest paying gig by far at that point, said, "I hope you'll come back next year." And anything was better than my hometown of Syracuse. When I played there, a loud acoustic player doing punk and spoken word, it was too alien. "He has two heads. He's not the same as us. We must kill him." Austin was different. No paying gigs, to be sure, but you could do a shitload of open mics to hone your craft and hopefully kick their ass to get your name around. I had a temp job, working with the state by day, a key punch gig, and Monday nights I could hit two open mics, Tuesday three if I ran around fast enough, and I never missed all three, Wednesday and Thursday two each. There were none on the weekends, but sometimes you could score an opener. Alejandro Escovedo was always good to me. Maybe you could get your own gig, and there were a ton of benefits to play. And unlike other towns I had lived in Austin, people actually came out for the benefits. Somebody had seen me at an open mic and called me to do a benefit for the Police Benevolent Association. I rarely work in cahoots with the police, but they were building a shelter for battered children. Of course, I was in. I remember it being a gorgeous day. I was relatively new to town, but it was brutally apparent immediately how great the weather was compared to living in upstate New York. There were a ton of bands that day. Rockabilly, surf, country, Tejano, Tex-Mex, Zydeco, polka, swing, singer-songwriters, and even Scottish bagpipes. It started at noon and ended at 2 a.m. My set was at 5:00. It went pretty well. I wanted to hang around, but my wife was sick, so I needed to get home to take care of her. I was bringing my gear to my car when I was approached by three young kids, two guys and a girl, in their early teens. They were all pumped up, red in the face, enthusiastic. "We really liked what you did." They had a ton of questions. "What do you call that? How do you get that guitar to sound like that? Where are you from? What do you listen to? Do you have any CDs?" I was flattered. Gave them the scoop as best I could. I really had nothing going on then. I turned the line of inquiry to them. They were in a band. Hardcore, straight edge, metal punk. The Disconnected. They showed me their card. It said it all right there, including the biggest text of all. No ballads. Big, bold letters. No ballads. Serious. I asked them what time they were playing. 2:30 a.m., they said. I thought for a second, pulled a homer. "Wait a minute," I said. "The benefit ends at 2. They said, "Yeah, the promoter is afraid that we'll scare people away, so he's going to let us play when everybody leaves." I admired their spunk. I loved to play too, and I understood. They kept going on about the hailstorm they went through to get there. They came from Corpus Christi, but the bass player, the driver, the only one old enough for a license, said he never went below 65. I was unfamiliar with Texas. I asked him how long it took to get there, and he said 3 hours. 3 hours to play to nobody. For free. When I was in 7th grade, two of my first concerts were Jimi Hendrix and The Who. The Who with Keith Moon. It kind of fucked me up for life, setting the bar astronomically high. I play with a million young bands now, who come up to me and ask, "How'd you like our band?" I was 12 years old when The Who came out, did these incredible songs, played great, sang great, wrecked their gear, fought with each other, and the most amazing drummer in the world died and was resurrected every night. That was a fucking band. I carried Sleater-Kinney's gear into a club once, and the lead singer pouted through the whole set because it was too hot in Texas. I'd been all excited for the saviors of rock and roll that night. Never believed spin. I told the Disconnected that I'd try to come back to see them at 2:30, and I did. Sure enough, everybody had gone. and they played to an enormous field under the Texas stars to me and three of their friends. They were fucking great. They played like their lives depended on it, fast, furious, passionate, for every battered kid that gig was benefiting. I helped them load into their car. I couldn't have put them up. My apartment was too small. My wife was sick. So I don't know why I asked, but I did. Are you going back tonight, or are you staying? They said they were staying. They wanted to hit the record stores tomorrow. Do you have a place to stay? Oh, yeah, they replied. We're staying at a friend's. I was relieved. I was off the hook. Yeah, they grinned. He won't be there, but he says we can stay in his yard.